Good afternoon. So I'm Yogesh. I'm at the CDS department here at IISc. And I'm a distributed systems researcher by training. I'm not an AI researcher. So I'll slightly take a liberal view of sustainability, not necessarily sustainability for the cities, but it's a two-step thing to sustainability of cities. I'll be talking about how we can I'll be drawing on experiences from a few projects I've been involved with, some actually starting back at USC as part of my earlier avatar as a research faculty, but also here at IISc as part of a smart campus project for water management and also as part of a smart city testbed, which Bharadwaj will be talking about next. But broadly, this gets into the area of being able to collect data as part of the IoT, Internet of Things, installation of sensors and actuators through various city and community scale granularities, right? Kruti mentioned about how you can use sensing at the classroom level and by building models for doing it within classrooms. So we've done some work on smart water management by measuring water level, deploying water level sensors on overhead tanks and so on. And as part of smart city testbed, we have things like cameras and so on going off to the field. But the key point over here is that you have the ability to measure a lot of parameters in an automated fashion, continuous fashion, throughout our urban environments, right? And the question really comes into what can you do with such data, right? And typically, if you look at analytics broadly, right, and AI is just one part of the entire analytics pipeline, it's about acquiring the data, cleaning it, integrating it, storing it, and doing online analytics on top of that, building models on that, and so on. And finally, closing the loop, where you actually go and perform an intervention, right? And this closing the loop has sort of two aspects. One is conceptually closing the loop, right? I measure, let's say, temperature in the room, and you, based on that and the current temperature and the models and so on, I might go and intervene on the AC unit, right? But it's also physical closing the loop, because oftentimes what happens is that this acquisition pipeline might go through a large computational cycle, but typically the sensing and the actuation are physically proximate to each other, and that's an important point. But the key point is that AI itself is enabled by the ability to collect data and availability of all this data, and AI is going to help with the sustainable infrastructure and cities and so on. So one of the key benefits of all this data being out there is sort of the advances we've seen in deep learning, right? So you got a lot of data collected from all around, and you have also access to computing resources, unlike anything before, right? You can sort of, on the drop of a pin, you can go and sort of get computer resources on your favorite cloud or buy a GPU and do way more than you could a few years back. And in this context, we soon realized that, especially working at scalable systems and so on, a lot of the data collected from sensors like temperature and water and so on is not a large in size. And there are typically point observations about a specific type of entity, right? When we started working with video data, we realized that video is actually a meta sensor. You can actually do a lot more with just a single frame of video than I could with maybe 20 sensors I install over there. Partly because you have context, you actually have a bunch of different parameters. So video data combined with deep learning can actually be a very powerful mechanism. And that essentially tells you that one form of sustainability is actually reducing how much sort of computing devices you put out there or how much physical devices you put out there, right? So we are looking at how can you actually reduce the physical deployment and do more with video streams and AI. And in this context, taking it to the computing side of things, we realized as part of various city and campus deployments that we were not just deploying sensors and actuators, but we were actually deploying computing devices on the field without realizing it upfront, right? Like a Raspberry Pi has actually got more computing power, way more than maybe a PC I had 10 years back, right? And oftentimes these were used just to collect data and push them off to the cloud for further processing, right? And we ran a bunch of experiments in terms of the compute capacity of these Raspberry Pis and so on. And we actually found that they almost, maybe three Raspberry Pis are almost the equivalent of one, let's say, virtual machine running on the cloud. So one of the advantages of cloud computing, which typically is used in many of the smart city projects, is that you have elastic availability of resources on the fly. You can acquire and release machines. You don't have to maintain them. So these are sort of the good parts. But some of the not so good parts are the fact that you have a lot more network latency going from the edge where the physical infrastructure is to the cloud in the data center. And the bandwidth can sometimes be constrained if you think about high bandwidth applications like video, right? So we started looking at how can you make use of these edge computing devices on the order of, let's say, Raspberry Pi class devices. And you also are starting to see even GPU-enabled edge devices, sometimes called fog devices, like NVIDIA's DX1 that cost maybe a couple of $100, which could actually be on the field, closer to where the data is being collected. So these are good in the sense that the network latency between the data collection, decision-making, and the control can be reduced, and the bandwidth potentially within a smaller private network is much more available than between the edge and the cloud. But you also have challenges such as it's not as elastic. In fact, it's not elastic compared to, let's say, cloud virtual machines. And there are reduced capacities and battery availability and reliability and so on that you have to deal with, right? But for us, the broad question was, if you combine edge devices with cloud devices, can you do more than just using cloud resources, right? And one of the big challenges that we noticed when it came to using such edge devices for making decision making within smart cities was that there was no easy way to program them or access them or deploy applications on them, right? That sort of led to a small activity where we looked at how can you take, just like you would, let's say, compose a Spark or a MapReduce or a TensorFlow job, and you'd run them and let the platform figure out where things run and so on. Can you do that more broadly across edge and cloud devices, right? So here we essentially put together a small platform which we call Echo, not related to Amazon's Echo. It's an unfortunate choice of acronym. But here the idea is that you can compose your own decision-making application as a DAG of tasks. We actually support both streaming data, which is typical for sensor-based data, as well as batch data, which might be more common for doing training on historic data and so on. And one of the things that we tried not to do was reinvent the wheel and come up with, or claim to come up with the next big Hadoop or Spark or so on. We essentially said that, hey, you essentially want a thin layer that can allow you to access various distributed platforms, but make use of existing software platforms that already exist, right? So things like Edgent or Storm or NiFi and so on, which already are doing, in the big data platform space, doing a very mature job, we plug into those and instead give a sort of a facade on top of them. And we enable, one of the key advantages is that we enable orchestration across various types of these edge, fog, and cloud devices in a distributed setup, right? And a couple of interesting things that we sort of were cognizant of when we started actually sort of trying to deploy it and so on, is that when you have an Internet of Things IoT deployment, there's a lot of network asymmetry in the sense that a lot of sensors and gateways might be behind private networks, right? And you might be able to connect from one device to another, but not the other way around. So as part of our actual deployment and orchestration of these applications, we make sure that there is connectivity either in either one of the two directions, or it goes through things like third parties and so on. These are things that you don't want the developer to think about and have the platform give you out of the box, which is something that we do. Another thing to be cognizant of is the fact that you have devices that could be dying once you put them on the field, right? So trust me, when it comes to hardware deployment and maintaining it on the field, it is not easy, right? As software designers, we actually have life easy. And I really pity people who work on the field with hardware devices. So you actually want to make sure that if things go kaput, you can actually move things on the fly, right? Migrate them from, let's say, applications that are running on one device off to another device that's available based on the current situation that's out there, right? Just to sort of give you a sort of high-level overview of how things work, you have a bunch of different devices, edge, fog, cloud. Basically have our platform services, that central core platform services that run on the cloud, but also a bunch of very lightweight services that run on various computing devices which you might be using. And on top of that, we also allow users to bring in their own favorite runtime engine, be it NiFi, TensorFlow, Edgent, Storm, and so on. And then when a user comes in and wants to run that application, right, say it might be doing some kind of predictive modeling and so on, you can sort of bring it in and that gets automatically deployed across the various devices based on what's available and so on. And the whole thing gets going and you can rebalance it and things like that as might be the need, right? Just to give you a flavor of some of the applications that we have gotten working on this Echo platform, and all of these are actually real applications based on our experiences with our smart city and smart test bed projects. So one is just a classic ETL, extract, transform, load pipeline, right? You want to acquire the data, store it off into permanent storage, and later on come back and take a look at it, right? Here, meaning our original version before the advent of Echo, was to just run it using Apache Storm, which is a stream processing system from Twitter, on the cloud exclusively. But with something like Echo going, you can actually do part of the pre-processing where you do parsing and sort of data transmission and so on the edge devices and just hand it off to cloud once you go past here, right? Another slightly more interesting application, right, especially in the context of AI and deep learning, is one we are actually doing video analytics where we have streams of video data coming in and we want to do classification, right? And here you might actually want to do low granularity classification on the edge, and if something interesting comes out, you might actually want to push it off to the cloud with a high-end GPU and then do more concrete classification. So you spend the bandwidth only if something interesting comes between the edge and the cloud, but otherwise do things exclusively on the edge, right? So these are a couple of examples. We have other deep learning examples as well, which I won't go to in the interest of time, but if you want to, you can actually play it out. You can download this Echo platform and play around with it. It's available on our GitHub page, right? Just to sort of conclude, bunch of interesting possibilities that come out. This is more a platform play so far, but there's much more interesting research coming out of that. How do you compose DAGs so that users compose it, and the system automatically figures out what engine to use. Right now, it's very prescriptive. The user specifies. You can do it automatically. How can you schedule in an automated fashion? And down the line, how can you even do distributed training of some of these deep learning models? Because that oftentimes is the biggest bottleneck. Right now, we focus more on the inferencing part, right? So again, a bunch of collaborators to thank, I thank you all for your attention.
Quick question?
Yeah.
So does it work with the user devices? Does it work with devices other than, say, Raspberry Pi?
We look at a Pi class device or higher, right? So it depends on, for example, 1 GB memory and 1 GHz CPU core might be the baseline, right? But it won't work with, let's say, low-end modes and so on. It's not designed for that.